From Phenix Municipal Stadium in Phenix City, Alabama, just across the state line from Columbus, Georgia, in the southern part of our country, welcome to the NCAA Division III Championship game featuring the Widener Pioneers out of Chester, PA, and the University of Dayton Flyers. Hi once again, everybody. Vern Lundquist along with Tom Gatewood as we bring you the culmination of this search for the championship that began among 188 teams back in September. Tom, they were ranked number one and number two at the end of regular season. It's very fitting that they have advanced to this spot. And interestingly enough, these teams appear to be on paper very evenly matched.
They're very evenly matched, both offensively and defensively, as far as giving up points and scoring points. They're very much in the same kind of a category. The key in the ballgame could be turnovers. And so far, in two playoff games, Widener is guilty of not only making seven fumbles, but losing seven fumbles. So that's going to be very, very key for them. They've got to be consistent. They've got to give it to Dayton, because Dayton is the defending champion.
Dayton and Widener have been here in Phenix City most of this week. They came down for the pregame festivities. And here come the Widener Pioneers. Their head coach is Bill Van Love. He's in his 13th year. They are ranked number one in NCAA Division III, and you see a reflection of why with that 12-0 record so far this season. Widener will be dressed in the blue and the white. University of Dayton with brand new uniforms just for this day that says Stagg Bowl on the back. Dayton Flyers won this game a year ago under then head coach Rick Carter, and here they come under their first year head coach Mike Kelly. The Flyers of Dayton, their only defeat of the year to Eastern Kentucky, 14-3. Be Widener against Dayton from Phenix City, Alabama. It's a championship match, the first of our two games on NCAA football. We'll be back with the kickoff right after this. We are back in Phenix City, Alabama, the Widener Pioneers and the Dayton Flyers. A very strong wind of some 20 to 25 miles an hour blowing from left to right out of the north. A cold front came through. Dayton has won the toss, and they have elected to receive. And I'm a little surprised that Widener chose to... Well, they took the win. I'm not surprised at that at all. I suddenly realized that's the direction the wind is coming from. Deep man is Nick Rickey, number 39. And Nick Poulos will kick off for the Widener Pioneers. Rickey is the middle of three men deep. And we're set to go with NCAA Division III college football. Nick Poulos, number five, raises his arm, and here we go. He'll ride the wind deep. It'll be taken by Rickey at the five. Watch out for the reverse. No, Rickey still has it. He's out to the 20, weaving out to the 25, struggles out to the 28-yard line, and has a first down 10 with a 25-yard return. Offensive starters for the University of Dayton Flyers. The quarterback is John Vorp, a junior out of Cincinnati. Chris Pappas is the fullback, number 34. Greg Bazzani is the tailback. He's a junior from Deep Haven, Minnesota. Breeze Roller, the split end. And Dave Turkowski is the flanker back, a senior from Kettering, Ohio. First down 10, ball spotted just shy of the 29-yard line. Reverse, around the right side it goes. Taken by Rick Haynes, who was snuck in there as a flanker back, number 20, and it's good for an 11-yard gain. Offensive line, Fred Domicone from Fairborn, Ohio. Dave Merrill, the left guard out of Geneva, Ohio. Mike Howard is the center from Philadelphia, PA. Joe Beck on the right side. And the right tackle is Larry Armstrong, a senior out of Hillsboro, Ohio. The tight end is Kirk Ambrose. First down 10 at the 41-yard line. High formation, Turkowski starts in motion. Pitch out goes to Pizzani with Pappas in front. And he is dragged down up at the 45-yard line after a gain of about five. Defensively, Widener will run a 4-3 defense. You're looking now at Chris Bazzani, Greg Bazzani, out with a broken ankle early in the year, Tom.
He's running real well now. He's been in both playoff games so far, and he's picked up a couple of touchdowns in those playoffs, so he's very, very consistent for them. They need him.
John Vorp, a junior quarterback, has thrown for 1,500 yards so far this year. It'll be second down at four at the 45. Bazzani gets knocked to his knees as he gets the ball, and the tackle is made by Bob Beely, number 83, a senior out of Warminster, Pennsylvania. And that'll bring up a third down. The defensive line has Tony Stefanoni, Bob Mealy, Jim Devlin, and Dennis Sheedy as the front four. The linebackers are Phil Arufo, Jeff Schreider, and Tim Kaiser. The quarterbacks, Jim Hirschman and Bob O'Toole. And the safeties are Tom Deary, the All-American, and Lou Irving. Third and four, Dayton at their own 47. Mazzani again, cutback play. He's got a first down, 10-plus. Finally tackled at the 47, but they keep the drive alive after a six-yard gain. Tackle made by Phil Arufo, a junior out of Marlton, New Jersey. Our referee today is Rod Daly. Clark Gaston, the umpire. Billy Schrader, the head linesman. Ernest Beeson, the line judge. Joe Long, the field judge. And Gil Rushton is the back judge. First and 10, Dayton. I formation, straight to the formation to the left side. Fullback gets the get this time, Pappas, and he is shoved backwards almost immediately.
The Pioneers are starting to figure out that misdirection type offense that Dayton is using so far. It has worked for them very, very well because a lot of people going in motion, a lot of movement back there, unlike the other ball club, unlike Widener, because Widener, when you see them on offense the next time when they get the ball, you'll see that they're mostly a straight ahead club, but Dayton goes misdirection, so it works very, very well for them.
Second down, 10. Warp has yet to throw in the ball game. Option play, Warp keeps it. Cuts over his left tackle spot, or right tackle, and gets down to the 41-yard line. Last man up is number 64, Tony Stefanoni, a junior out of Florence, New Jersey. You're looking, meanwhile, at John Thorpe, a junior out of Cincinnati. He's picked up 254 yards rushing this year. He was a backup to Jim O'Hara most of last year. But then when O'Hara got injured in the championship game or the semifinal game at Widener, he led them to the come-from-behind victory and then starred in the 63-0 win here. Third down and five. Warp gets a great block, but Tim Kaiser, the junior linebacker, senior linebacker, fought off that block and made the tackle. That brings up the fourth down. Look at it again as Thorpe tried to come left for the first down.
Kaiser used to be a running back before they moved into linebacker. His nickname is the Doctor of Destruction, and you see, he just kind of fights off the blockers and makes the stop of the quarterback in the backfield.
Fourth down. Lon Marino is on to punt and goes off the side of his foot. Very poor kick into the wind. Tom Deary was back. We'll see where they spot it. They're going to spot it at the 30-yard line. It's a 12-yard punt. On offense for the Widener Pioneers now, the quarterback is Bobby Cole. Jerry Irving, the running back. Fullback is Gary Clofine out of Havertown, PA. Tom Kincaid at split end. And Tony Britton is the slot back, West Long Branch, New Jersey. First down, 10 at the 31-yard line. Bobby Cole gives it off to his tailback, Jerry Irving. And it's good for a gain of four. The offensive line for the Pioneers, Tim Mooney at left tackle from Pleasantville, New Jersey. Paul Fay, the left guard. Adam Stefanoni, junior out of Florence, is the center. Tom Sutton, the right guard out of Philadelphia. Dave Sinti is the right tackle. And the tight end is Tim Burns from Brigantine, New Jersey. Second and six. Fullback gets to give. It's Jerry Irving again. And Jim Pearson makes the nose guard makes the tackle. Let's take a look at the defensive unit now for Dayton. They will run a 5-2. Joe Vogel, Joe Drobnitz, Jim Pearson, Brett Prozel, Rick Callinan, the defensive line. The linebackers are Mark Hufford and Gareth Dickey. In the defensive secondary, Nick Cuglieri, Clay Robinson, Doug Conley, and Chris Cheney, the All-American free safety. Third and two, a long two at the 38-yard line. Jerry Irving again, fighting for the first down. He will be close, down at the 41. They might have to bring the chain on and see if he got it.
Pretty good standoff, Vern, up front as far as the man-for-man type of situation is concerned. The offense for Widener averages 6 foot, 215 pounds across the front, and defensive line for Dayton is 6'1", 206. So man for man, they're pretty even, and you got almost a stalemate there on that last third down plunge trying to get the first down.
Here's the stretch of the chain, and the Pioneers come up short. Mark Steffen will come on to punt for them. And Nick Rickey will go deep for Dayton. On fourth and a foot, they will not take the gamble. We have 10:05 remaining in the first quarter of play. No score in this Division III championship encounter from Phenix City, Alabama. Mark Steffen, number one. There's Nick Rickey, who returned the opening kickoff 25 yards, and he is waiting now at the 15-yard line. Steffen is also the place kicker for the Widener Pioneers. Oh, nice kick with the win. Rickey at the 10. Cannot break loose, and he's down at the 17-yard line. That's a 50-yard kick, 7 on the return. The hang time was 3.9. Pete Stolzer made the tackle. There's a timeout in the field. No score, Widener and Dayton. We've got 9 minutes and 41 seconds remaining first quarter. No score in the game. Division III championship encounter from Phenix Municipal Stadium in Phenix City, Alabama. The Dayton Flyers have got the ball for the second time. They advanced as far as the 41-yard line of Widener last time out, but the drive stalled. In the background, you see some of band members coming in. There was a Christmas parade here in Phenix City this morning. They've got a 1,000-piece combined high school band that will entertain at halftime. They got stuck in the parade and are just now getting here to the game. First down and 10. John Vorp, the quarterback, backs in the eye, two wide receivers to the right side. Gibb goes to his fullback, Big Chris Pappas. Tackle is made by Dennis Sheedy, number 66. Pappas trying to get a block from Mike Howard, the center out of Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. You look at Howard on the left-hand side there. Take a look at Tom Deary as the play ends. He's number 13.
Well, he is, again, the All-American defensive secondary man. They're the guy, they want to pick on him all day long to try to intimidate him a little bit, maybe take his mind off the concentration of the game.
That was Fred Domicone, the left tackle, who had the block on him. It's second down and 8 right now. Fake to the fullback, Vorp has it, bad pitch out, fumble, scramble for the ball. Who got it? We talked about turnovers at the top of the show. The Widener Pioneers have got it. Dennis Sheedy, number 66, a senior out of Conshohocken, Pennsylvania.
There you see quarterback belly faking into the fullback, Bazzani. Then he tries to pitch out wide to the tailman and hits him in the left shoulder. He's got to get the ball out front. He didn't do that, and Sheedy comes up with the recovery, and now the Widener team has the football going the other way.
Hand off right side. What a hit at the line of scrimmage. Carry is made by Gary Copeland. And Mark Huffert made the tackle. The linebacker, a senior out of Hamilton, Ohio. Interesting the way this Widener offense lines up. The two backs take a four-point stance, Tom.
It almost looks like the old Texas wishbone type setup where they used to have three backs in tandem lining up. They're almost close enough to touch each other there.
Everybody on the line in the four-point stance. Here's the first pass. Tom Kincaid at the 15, at the 10, ankle tackle at the 8-yard line. Kincaid, the leading receiver on the ball club. That's his 40th catch this year. It's good for a gain of 22.
We've got a low angle shot here. Situation where the Widener team has been on the ground mostly, and very, very unusual for them to throw on first down. They catch the Dayton team sleeping. Kincaid makes the catch. He's missed a touchdown. He's got 19 career touchdown passes for this Widener football team, so he's a big threat.
Including 7 this year. Slot back formation. The handoff goes to Clofine, the fullback, number 43. And he chugs down to the 5-yard line, and Jim Pearson, the nose guard, makes the tackle. Clofine, Bill Manlove told us, is one of the keys for them today. He's been unable to play a full game all year because of a variety of injuries.
I tell you, they really need them to hold on to the football here. It's very, very cold here. It's sunny. It looks like a warm day, but it is not. They've got to be very careful down here in the scoring area.
I'll tell you how cold it is. We sent out for the long johns when we got here this morning. Here's the handoff. Oh, there's a fumble again. Now a scramble, and Widener's got it. Bobby Cole recovered the mishap, but it'll be third and goal. Watch the fumble now from down low.
This particular situation was not a matter of cold hands. It's just a miscue on the exchange. He's trying to ride the ball into the fullback, first man through, and then pull it out and perhaps run the option. They were not able to pull it out as the fullback was grabbing for the football.
Third and goal from the 8. Both wide receivers to the left side. Play fake, Cole to throw. Down the middle it goes, intercepted. Picked off by Chris Cheney, and he makes the mistake of running it out to the 1-yard line. There's Cheney's ninth interception this year, and he's upset with himself for running it out. He could have had the touchback.
Absolutely right, Vern. He should stay in the end zone on this particular play and get the ball 20 yards downfield. Instead, Cole stands up and throws the ball pretty well, but he does not see the safety man hanging back there in that home run area.
So it'll be first down for Dayton, but they're 99 yards away from pay dirt. Timeout on the field. 6:54 remaining first quarter. No score in the game. We've had an exchange of turnovers thus far, and John Thorpe is the man under center now. Mike Howard is the center. And the handoff goes to Pisani, who is hit immediately and knocked back into the end zone, but his forward progress will be to the line of scrimmage. I think it's fairly easy to understand how Chris Cheney could make that mistake, but it might prove costly for them.
Well, he's a big play man, and again, you know, he's the kind of guy who can take it 100 yards anytime he's got the ball, so he's thinking, get the ball in the end zone all the time, and sometimes you just kind of lose track of where you are on the field.
Interesting matchup. Widener's defense, very stingy. They've yielded only an average of 8 points per game, and Dayton has been a high-scoring club. They've been scoring at a rate of about 29 points per game. Split backs this time. One wide receiver to the left side, one to the right. Hand off over the right tackle spot goes to Pisani again, or Chris Pappas it is. And it'll be third and about eight. 5:06:04 remaining in the first quarter. Vern Lundquist and Tom Gatewood here in Phenix City, Alabama. First of our two games today, we'll have the traditional Army-Navy clash from Philadelphia coming up as the second half of our doubleheader.
Well, they may be just trying to punch the ball out a little bit further to give the punter a little bit more room to punt the ball here. Look to keep the ball on the ground.
Kincaid is split to the left side. They will give it off to the fullback. He almost broke it open, but it'll be short of the first down as Chris Pappas, the junior out of Chicago, picked up a gain of 4, and the punting unit comes on. Lon Marino is the punter. He shanked one last time out, only 12 yards, and he's kicking into about a 20-mile-an-hour breeze. Tom Deary will wait for it, and he'll take up his post at the 45-yard line of Dayton. There's a look at Marino, who had a great game last week in their win over Lawrence. Left-footed kicker, and again hung up by the wind. It will bounce and gets a Dayton roll all the way across midfield. He really got the push on the ball out of the roll, and it's down at the 45-yard line. So Dayton has yielded the ball on a 47-yard kick, nothing on the return. The Widener Pioneers have it with a first down 10 right after this message. Widener Pioneers' third offensive set now. They've got it 55 yards away with the wind at their back. Unable to capitalize on the last turnover. Quick count. The handoff goes to Jerry Irving for a tough 2 or 3 yards over left tackle. Tried to get blocks from Paul Fay and Tim Mooney on that right side, but Fred Prozel, number 70, was there to put the plug in the effort. Take a look at this four-point stance now that Widener lines up in.
Yeah, they're basically, they're about 6 inches apart. You can see they can touch each other's hands here on this particular stance. They look like sprinters ready for a 100-yard dash.
Really does. It's a track stance, isn't it?
Absolutely right.
Mike Kelly, the Dayton coach, is saying, I don't see how they get out of that thing. There's a play fake and Cole to fire. Pitch it off. Cheney again. Oh, my gosh. What a great play by Chris Cheney, the senior out of Hamilton, Ohio. Now, he was a defensive end a year ago. He played his first 2 years at Marshall University and transferred, then sat out. Was a defensive end a year ago. We'll look again.
Cheney certainly knows where he is on the field on this play. He's just following the eyes of the quarterback. As you see, he's watching all the way, watching the play. Then he steps up with that great speed that he has, picks it off, tries to tape rope down the sideline to pick up additional yardage because he knows where that end zone is, too.
Ball spotted at the 49-yard line. Two turnovers now, and timeout has been called. There was a problem with the football, and each team uses its own ball, and they've got the Widener ball in there. They want the Dayton ball back.
No, they want the Gucci ball.
No, the Gucci ball.
They're absolutely right. You got to have the right name on that ball, you know?
I knew they were into leather goods.
That's all it was at Notre Dame. Come on.
All right. You used the Gucci ball at Notre Dame.
Absolutely, absolutely.
I knew Notre Dame went first class. Here's Thorpe to throw. He's got a man wide open. That's Turkoski with a first down at the 34-yard line. Dave Turkoski. Tom Deary made the tackle, but not before we had a 17-yard gain. Thorpe to Turkoski. Ball has been spotted at the 34. I mean, they both got to have the same amount of air pressure in them.
Oh, certainly, certainly. Okay.
Thorpe on the year, 1,500 yards, 9 touchdowns, and 12 interceptions. Here's a reverse coming left. It's Rick Haynes. Haynes breaks the tackle. He's at the 20. He is knocked down at the 14-yard line. Lou Irving made the stop. Junior out of Cincinnati, Ohio, on the reverse.
Let's watch Rick Haynes come toward us on the play here. Again, misdirection, and the flanker reverse. A lot of deception on the part of Dayton and the coach, Mike Kelly. He just wants to make him out of their box, and that's exactly what he does, as Haynes picks up valuable yardage and then turns on the speed.
Dayton's deepest penetration in the first quarter. High formation again. Pisani gets the handoff and a tough yard or so. Jim Devlin, number 70, made the tackle, the right tackle.
It's interesting, Vern, the fact that in this day and age of freshman eligibility to play on varsity, on the field right now, the 22 players that are there, there's not one freshman out there on that football field. You think they want it? I mean, they're here to play to win. They want the most seasoned players on that football field.
We've got under 3 minutes remaining first quarter. Slot eye formation to their slot formation, no eye formation. Here's Thorpe to throw again. Into the end zone it goes. Caught, touchdown. Tom Kincaid. That's the 20th touchdown catch of his career, a 13-yard TD toss.
That's reception number 34 on the season.
It was Haynes, I'm sorry. And the Dayton crowd is celebrating. Rick Haynes made the catch. Now the extra point attempt from Mike Pinatello. This could make it 7-0. Kick is up. Got it. A 55-yard drive for the Dayton Flyers. They take an early lead, and we'll look at the touchdown again.
Here's Thorpe on a option, kind of a rollout. You're going to see him throw the ball off the hip. And he can do it because he's got the threat to run or throw. And you can see Haynes making a catch and then dropping the feet.
We get three more tries. It's Bruce Roller who made the catch.
Bruce Roller. The sunshine, a little bit of a glare here. You see him, number 29, absolutely.
There we had a clear view of it. It's number 29, Brees Roller, who made the catch over the far corner. Got a little confused as to who it was, but we do know it's 7-0. Dayton over Widener in the first quarter. 2:49 to go, a 55-yard drive after Cheney's second interception of the game.
The key for Roller is he remembered to drag those feet in the end zone. In college, you only need to have one. He made sure he had at least one for the score.
Pinatello will kick off, and the deep man is Tom Deary. 7-0 score, Dayton. And Pinatello's going to come up and make sure it's set. There's a look at the All-American, three-time All-American. And he had a kickoff return of 100 yards last week in the win over Montclair State. Deary at the five. Stopped at the 25-yard line, from which point the Widener offense comes back on the field. Two big plays in that 55-yard drive. The reverse, Rick Haynes, a pickup of 20. There was also a Tarkowski catch of 17. And then the 13-yard touchdown toss, John Thorpe to Brees Roller. And here come the Widener Pioneers. Jerry Irving again. Nope, it's Kofine on the pitch out, left side. And he gets a couple of yards to the 27-yard line. Jim Pearson, the nose guard, made the stop. Cole gets up. He kept it.
Yeah, Widener's starting to get a little bit more open, a little bit looser now. They're coming up and they're spreading out. They're sending the tight end out a little bit wider, a little bit of motion. Just trying to get themselves a little bit more loose and into the ball game because they really haven't been in the flow.
Cole is one out of three and has been intercepted twice. He's got it going deep across the middle. Caught. Catch is made by Tony Britton, number 27. A 16-yard gain.
Very, very good fake here. Belly fake in the line. They've been running that play quite a bit. It sets up the play to Britton. Britton's the number two receiver on this Widener football team. He makes a good catch in a crowd. Excellent sign of a good receiver.
Mark Hufford made the tackle. The ball spotted at the 48. Safety blitz from Cheney. Cole still has it, and he picks up 5 yards. Cheney came roaring through from his free safety spot, but there was a good block in the offensive line, and he did not get to Bobby Cole. Scoring drive, officially 51 yards, 57 rather, 13-yard gain for the touchdown. Second down at 5, 1:15 to go first quarter. They'll throw it again behind Kincaid, but he makes the catch, and that should be enough yardage for a first down at the 46-yard line. Dennis Coper, number 11, makes the tackle on Tom Kincaid.
Identical play that we saw earlier in the quarter with Kincaid just kind of running a stop pattern about 5 yards beyond the line of scrimmage. They got to have respect for him because he does have the speed to get by that secondary, but they've got to be very, very cautious. They don't want to throw it inside where Mr. Cheney is, number 85.
Slot formation to the left side. Cole will throw again, maybe. Rolls out, now he's going to run. Knocked out of bounds at the 41-yard line. Tackle is made by number 11, Dennis Coper, and that stops the clock with 43 seconds to go in the first quarter.
Cole simply had nowhere to go. They had excellent coverage in the secondary with Puglieri, Conley, Cheney, and Robeson covering everybody like a blanket on the play. He just decided to eat the ball and run it and try to pick up some kind of yardage. He picked up about 5. There's 43 seconds left on the clock.
Second down and 5, 7-0. Dayton has the lead over the Widener Pioneers, Division III championship game. Blitz coming again. Cole hands it off. On the reverse, it goes to Tony Britton, number 27, and Coper stops him. But it's another first down, 10 for the Widener Pioneers. Using that misdirection this time.
There you see Cole here faking the belly series and then giving the ball off to Britton. Britton's got over 300 yards rushing, so he can go either way. And he's got excellent hands. He's probably the most evenly gifted player on their team, can catch and run the football.
Mark Hufford was coming on the blitz for Dayton. They went right by him. They'll try it again. This time without any great degree of success. Number 98, Joe Vogel, defensively on top, and Jim Pearson, the nose guard, number 50, who has been all over the place here in the first quarter, which has now come to a close. So the Widener Pioneers are driving. The Dayton Flyers have a lead. They had a touchdown toss after a pass interception. 7-0 our score. Bill Manlove in his 13th year, and what a record he's achieved. 108 wins, only 23 defeats. Got a master's degree out of Temple University. Second down and 10, Bob Cole back to throw. Comes left side, man is open, it's caught. And he's bumped by the official out of bounds at the 35-yard line, Tom Kincaid with the catch. The senior from Ardmore, Pennsylvania. That's good for a gain of 9. Give you an end zone perspective now as you look at Tom Kincaid.
You watch the protection too, because this line is a brand new line. This offensive line graduated a year ago, so they had to replace it. Has Bill Manlove, and Kincaid makes the catch because Cole had plenty of time to throw it.
Third and 1 at the 25. And this time Widener's going into the wind. Oh my gosh, what a hit, recovered by Dayton. Joe Vogel comes up with it. What a pop at the line of scrimmage.
It's hard to pick out one jersey here because there's a bunch of people being stuffed. That offensive line that we just complimented gets stuffed. And 86, Rick Callinan is the man who comes up. The defensive end makes that slam tackle, causes the fumble, and the recovery by Joe Vogel, number 98.
Third turnover for Widener. Two pass interceptions and a fumble. Up the middle, Greg Mazzani, the tailback. Phil Arufo makes the tackle, the linebacker. Pisani, number 35. Third turnover for the Widener Pioneers, and they have had turnover problems, Tom, in the playoffs.
You're absolutely right, and speaking of the defensive end, Callanan for Dayton, he's still hot from last week. He had 8 solo tackles last week and 2 quarterback sacks in that ball game that they had against Lawrence, that 38-0 win over Lawrence.
Second down, 7. 7-0 lead. Dayton has it. Pitch out. Pisani with Pappas in front. Pappas had to try and fight off 2 defenders and got only 1, and Tom Deary made the tackle, number 13. Three-time All-American, had 9 interceptions last year, 10 this year, career is 29. And we'll take a look at Tom Deary as he made that last play.
Let's see how far he backpedaled before he fires forward. He took about a half a step back and said, hey, I've diagnosed this play. This is a run. Come up and make the stop.
He's 6'1", 190. It's 3rd down and 2. Blitz threatened now by the Widener defense. Handoff goes to Pisani. Stiff arm. He's got the 1st down plus. He is in the Widener country at the 48-yard line. Jim Hirschman made the tackle. And that stops the clock with 14:02 to go in the first half. A look at the Widener Pioneer defense from Chester, Pennsylvania.
That run by Pisani was set up by an excellent block by the fullback Chris Pappas. Stood up the defensive end on that side.
Slot man goes to the left side this time. There's a look at Pisani for the year. Again, hurt earlier with a broken ankle. Reverse is faked and Thorpe's in trouble. He's got a free lance and level play. Gets 1 block, 2 blocks, and gets back for a loss of only 2. He ran 30 to lose 2. And Tony Stefanoni finally forced him out of bounds. Widener had great pursuit from the outset.
Absolutely.
Deary blitzing.
Here you've got a veteran line that knows when your quarterback is in trouble, you got to come back, peel back, and try to set up some things here. Deary is chasing the play. He gets hit. Didn't see the blocker coming at him, but the offensive line, very, very experienced, coming back to help him out.
Kirkoski in motion. Thorpe wants to throw and does. Catch is made and the tackle almost simultaneously. Brees Roller, who had the touchdown grab late in the first quarter, makes that catch, his 2nd of the day. And Jim Smith made the tackle, number 22.
Made the point earlier about the fact that Widener's got a young and inexperienced offensive line. Again, Dayton's got a very experienced line. They've got 3 or 4 seniors and only 1 junior up front, so they've been around quite a bit, and they're returning starters.
3rd and 5. Ball at the 43-yard line. Counter option. And Thorpe has enough for a 1st and 10, down to the 36. Georgia, an early lead over Georgia Tech, 14-0 in the first quarter. Our 2nd game of the doubleheader, of course, will be the Army-Navy clash from Philadelphia. That's coming up at 3:45 Eastern time. Regular season in college football winding down, but we'll have the Gator Bowl for you on ABC, as well as the Sugar Bowl coming up a little later on in the year. Handoff goes to Pappas, the fullback, and Jim Devlin is right in his face. It's 7-0. Dayton leads Widener. Division III championship game. I'm Vern Lundquist along with Tom Gatewood. And we've got 12:25 to go. There's a look at Mike Kelly, 33-year-old first-year head coach. He was a defensive coordinator at Dayton for 4 years under Rick Carter before assuming the reins this year when Carter moved on to Holy Cross. Trouble for Thorpe. He's caught. Tim Kaiser, number 44. He is the leading tackler on this Widener football team.
Hey, we got a blitz on this play. Number 44 is coming all the way, virtually untouched, as he wards off a blocker and makes the stop on Thorpe.
Well, that limits your options. It's now 3rd down and 19. Everybody go deep time.
Yeah, well, Dayton just wasn't able to pick up Kaiser blitzing on that play.
blitz this time. Thorpe across the middle, wide open is Ambrose, the tight end. He's to the 30, but short of the first down. Now, they do have the wind behind them, so we might see a field goal attempt as Tom Deary makes the stop on the big tight end. Kirk Ambrose, a senior out of Mentor, Ohio. 20 receptions for the year. He's now made his first of the day, and timeout has been called by the Dayton Flyers. They've got a fourth down and three with 11:07 to go in the first half, and they'll decide whether to go for the field goal or the first down. And while they're discussing that, we'll take a break. We'll return to Phenix City, Alabama, right after this message. There is a sizable contingent of Dayton fans who have made the trip down here from Ohio. And they're basking in the sunlight. Basking is the wrong term. It's cold. But they're enjoying the sun nonetheless. And Dayton will go for it on fourth and three. They will not try the field goal. Blitz coming from the Widener team. There's a fumble. And I think Tom Deary might have forced that fumble. He was coming and appeared to affect the concentration of John Thorpe on the pitch out to Chris and Greg Bazzani. Let's see if Deary was a factor here.
Again, Thorpe also didn't get the ball to Bazzani enough. He threw it on his left side, and Bazzani's trying to run with it instead of trying to make sure he's got it before he goes. But I think you're right. They're intimidating him a little bit on the other side of the field.
So, Widener's got the ball. Cole hands it off to Clofine. And the fullback gets a couple as Joe Drobnich, number 61, makes the tackle. 10:51 to go in the first half. This program is being brought to you as an exclusive presentation of ABC Sports. Now let's pause 5 seconds to allow our local stations to identify themselves.
WPVI TV, Channel 6, Philadelphia.
Second down, six. Goes to Clofine again, and he finds the door closed in his face by Jim Pearson, the nose guard, number 50. Middle man in that five-man front for the Dayton Flyers. 7-0 ball game. Dayton has the lead. It has been a turnover-filled ball game, but the turnovers thus far have been relatively even. It's 3-2.
And they really haven't been that much of a factor thus far in the ball game as far as leading to lots of scoring.
Third down, five. Pitch out, right side, Jerry Irving. He is short of the first down at the 43-yard line by about a yard. At the end of the first quarter, Tom, the statistics, and they relatively, I mean, reflect relative equality among these two teams. Total offense, 98-75.
Absolutely right. Really no edge there at all.
It'll be fourth down, and Mark Steffen comes on to punt for the second time. He will be kicking into the wind, and Nick Rickey is deep. There's Steffen. There's number one on his jersey. Line drive kick. Rickey will let it bounce, and now try the return. Shakes one man. Shakes another. Goes left and runs into traffic. Struggles out to the 27-yard line. 9 minutes and 9 seconds remaining in the first half of play. Dayton has a 7-0 lead. They've also got the ball. They have it at their own 26-yard line. Block from Brees Muller and picks up about 7 yards. Make to his new fullback who has just come in the game, Tom Hayner, number 32. So Bazzani and Hayner are the fullback, are the running backs now, and Thorpe still the quarterback. He's got another year left. He's just a junior out of Cincinnati. Nick Rickey has brought the play in from the bench. He and Roller come to the near side. And you look at Hayner, number 32, and Bazzani, the tailback. Pitch out. Hayner gets a block. Bazzani weaves for yardage. He's got a first and 10 out to the 42-yard line. Bazzani has now carried it 9 times. He's picked up 38 yards. He is the leading carrier in the ball game so far.
Bazzani showed a lot of poise on that play. Just kind of picked his way. Not in a hurry. Just follow my blockers. Let the big guys knock the guys down in front. I'll pick up the yardage. No sense of getting a lot of bruises along the way.
Stop the clock with 8:25 to go in the first half. And a first down, 10, Dayton. Incomplete. Intentional grounding. They threw the flag on John Vorp. And Vorp points over at Dave Turkoski to say he was throwing it at number five. But the referee, Rod Daly, threw the flag, intentional grounding.
I don't know if I buy it, Vern. He was at least within 3 yards of Turkoski.
Yeah, Turkoski was on the sideline. And now they're saying inadvertent flag. Exactly. They saw Turkoski after he threw the flag. So Rod Daly, I like to see that. Daly admits he made a mistake.
You mean they're human? They never told me that.
It was in the area of Dave Turkoski, an inadvertent flag, and it sets up a second down and 10. Draw play. And that one will go back to the drawing board. Pisani did not get anything. It'll be third and 10. Dennis Sheedy made the tackle that time, number 66. 8 minutes to go, first half, 7-0 game. Vorp is 4 out of 5 for 49 yards.
Vorp has really calmed down toward the tail end of the season. Last year, he had a lot of pressure on him. He was in the playoffs. He scored 2 touchdowns in each playoff game last year, leading to the championship. In the first part of this year, he was really inconsistent. He has been very consistent in the second half and in the playoffs so far.
Comes right side, intercepted. Picked off and flying down the sideline is Lou Irving. Irving is tackled at the 11. That's the fourth interception for Lou Irving this year. He returned at 37 yards, and that is the 37th interception for the Widener Pioneers in 1981.
Every time you pat somebody on the back, what do? Vorp sets up, he's trying to force the ball in. The receiver's not open at all. And Lou Irving steps in front, makes the catch. He's the brother of Jerry Irving. They're both from Pennsylvania. There he cuts back, and almost, he's thinking about goal line all the way, almost cuts back and makes the score.
37-yard return, Bob Cole. Counter option pitch out to Jerry Irving, whose brother just returned the interception, and he doesn't get anything. Both of these kids are very close friends of perhaps the most famous alum of Widener, Billy White Shoes Johnson.
Absolutely, Billy White Shoes. One of the all-time receivers and offensive weapons for Widener. Very influential and kind of talking the youngsters into coming here to be a part of this winning program that Bill Manloff has put together.
Second down and 9 from the 10. Cole has it. Into the end zone it goes. Incomplete. Into triple coverage and almost picked off by Nick Cuglieri. Clock is stopped with 6:48 to go, first half.
Situation like this, Cole has just got to maintain his cool here, not try to get it all in one bunch, just kind of peck away, take advantage of the turnover. This could lead to a score.
Cole for the day is 4 out of 7 for 55 yards. He'll throw it. Nobody open. Now lets it go. Incomplete in the end zone. Tremendous coverage in that end zone. That place was packed with red. He was looking for Kincaid, couldn't find him.
A situation like that, if the man is not open, you're better off eating the ball, running it, because you've got a field goal kicker on the sideline who for sure can put it through. Mark Steffen, number one, he's 14 for 18 on the season. You don't want to throw an interception and come away with no points. You want to come away with at least 3. That's what they're lined up to do right now, as Steffen lines up number one for the field goal attempt.
27-yard field goal to put Widener on the board. That's wide right. He didn't get it. He missed it wide to the right. Just pushed it. So the turnover goes for 9. Widener comes up empty, 6:34 to go, first half. Dayton still leads. Dayton cheerleaders have made the trip down from Ohio, and their team has the lead of 7-0. And the ball, first down at the 20-yard line. Tom Hayner, watch out. This will be Hayner's longest run by far. His previous long run was 10 yards. And he opens it up down the middle all the way to the 20-yard line. That's a 56-yard gain for Tom Hayner.
Hayner, the fullback, number 32,
the number one scorer on the Dayton ball club with 15 touchdowns, is a little surprised here. He looks up and all of a sudden there's nobody there. He's usually in on third down situations, goal line situations. All of a sudden it's a foot race and Deary is going to win it because Hayner is just not used to being on the open field that far, I tell you. He ran out of gas.
He might have slowed up from shock. Here's Pisani down to the 20-yard line. Hayner had gained 238 yards for the season, but his longest previous gain was 10 yards.
That's some kind of a run. That's a whole afternoon for you, I tell you.
It'll be second down and six at the 20-yard line. 5:45 to go in the first half, and Dayton on top, 7-0. Durkowski breaks and goes wide to the left side, and Brees Roller comes wide right. Roller has the touchdown catch, the only points scored thus far in the game. What a hit by Kaiser, the linebacker, number 44, on John Bork. It'll be third down and six. There's Kaiser.
Kaiser really does have a very, very well-deserved nickname, Doctor of Destruction. Look at those skull and crossbones on his helmet there. Those awards for defensive excellence. Number 44.
He's a senior out of Essington, Pennsylvania. Third and six. Tipped, intercepted. Kaiser's got it. That's his second interception of the year. Tim Kaiser comes up with a fourth turnover now for the Widener defense.
The next time tight end Kirk Ambrose looks at the film of this game, he's going to realize that when the ball is tipped and you're the receiver, primary target, start looking to make a tackle. He tries to, and he falls down, number 81, as Kaiser comes up with the interception. Here we go with an ISO on Kaiser, watching him read the play. He's watching quarterback's eyes first, then he starts looking for the receiver. He sees Ambrose, then all of a sudden he says, yes, it's mine. He tries to get the yardage, but he falls down.
4:48 to go in the first half. Time has been called. We'll be right back. Widener's got the ball at their own 16-yard line. First down and 10. We have had seven turnovers in the game, and somewhat amazingly, only one touchdown. And Cole is going to take a loss back to the 15. The quarterback is tackled by Mark Hufford, the linebacker, number 25. Bobby Cole, 4 out of 8 throwing the ball so far, has been intercepted twice.
Well, Widener's offense has got to get itself generated here a little bit. Look at that 210 to 95 yard edge that Dayton has in total offense thus far.
Kincaid comes wide to the left side, way wide. Split backs, the counter option going to the right side, the pitch back, a good block. Tom Sutton, right guard, was out there. And Joe Drobnich made the tackle on Jerry Irving, number 46.
The offense seems to translate some of that enthusiasm that Kaiser is showing on defense. You know, Brent pointed out, we talked to Manlove the other day, and he told us that Widener, of course, they won the championship, the national title in 77. Two members of that team are still playing on this football team. Kaiser is one of them, and Stefanoni, Mark Stefanoni, is the other player. Their fifth-year player is redshirted because of injury. They're the only two guys who have a championship ring.
Bobby Cole will not pass, hands it off to Britton, and Britton is going to be stopped. Tony Britton, the slot back, number 27. He's jammed up at the 21-yard line. It'll be fourth down. With 3:20 to go in the first half and the clock running, the only touchdown came on a 13-yard pass from John Vorp to Brees Roller. It followed the Chris Cheney interception. Now Mark Steffen is on to punt, and Nick Ricky will wait for it at the 45-yard line of Dayton. And as you watch Mark Steffen, keep in mind he's kicking into about a 20-mile-an-hour wind. Well, the wind has slowed up now. Look at the flagpole, and it's kind of subsided. Ricky on the run at the 47, to the 50, and down at the 49. Wide World of Sports returns next Saturday. ABC's Wide World of Sports at 5 o'clock Eastern Time. And it'll feature the North American Amateur Boxing Championships from Shreveport, Louisiana, and the National Championship Air Race from Reno, Nevada. Sparkling lineup when Wide World of Sports returns next Saturday on ABC. Dayton has the pigskin first down 10 at the 49-yard line of Widener. Hayner gets the handoff again. They're going to try that little plunge play, and it gets just about that, a little, about a yard. Bob Mealy, right tackle, makes the stop.
You know, Brian, we've been patting Dayton on the back, and Mike Kelly doing a fine job with his football team. They've got some scholars on that side. They've got John Vorp, got a 3.3 average in business. Pappas got 3.2, Roller 3.5, Armstrong 3.3. Pinatello is a 3.5 scholar with a GPA of 3.5. That's pretty good.
It'll be second down now. The handoff goes to Pizzani, and he's down on the 45-yard line. That will bring up a third down. And a need of six as Jim Devlin makes the tackle. There's a look at Kirk Ambrose, number 81, the tight end.
Yeah, we spent a lot of time quoting statistics on how many yards you run and how fast you run the 100. Those 3.5s, those 3.0s really mean something because you only play this game for so long, then you got to go do something else. And Mike Kelly is aware of that, cares a lot about his athletes. 8 out of 22 starters are 3.0 or better.
That's really something, really impressive. Warp to throw. Oh, it's bobbled. And I'll tell you what, if Reese Roller had been able to hang on, and he knows it, he might have been long gone. That could have been see you later.
Absolutely. Deary is about a step late. Number 13, the free safety, and picking this off. It's a matter of Kincaid just kind of stepping between people. Everybody tries to come up and make a stop here. Deary just a little late getting there. He was about a half a stride too late getting there to try to pick it off. Kincaid could have had six.
Lon Marino is on the punt now on fourth down. And they go for the block and don't get it. There's going to be a kicking call, roughing the kicker. So Dayton is going to get the ball back. Jim Smith came through. And forget where that ball is. We've got roughing the kicker. The Widener Pioneers went for the block, and that is the first penalty of the game. And it'll give Dayton sustained life at the 30-yard line. Rod Daly.
Roughing the kicker, defensive team, automatic first down, first and 10.
Watch it from the end zone, and you'll see number 22, Jim Smith, coming from the left side of the screen.
Just being aggressive here, but he's got to remember, he's got to go for the ball. He's a little bit too close to the punter. Go for the ball all the time and go beyond the punter.
1:23 to go first half. Option play left side. Wolf will hold on to it, and he dives down to the 25-yard line. Tackle made by Jeff Schreider, linebacker number 50. Clock still running with 1:05 to go. Turnover so far in the game, 4-3, but only a 7-0 lead for Dayton. Pizzani going left. He's got a first and 10 at the 16-yard line with 45 seconds to go in the first half. That's a 9-yard gain for Pizzani. Jim Hirschman and Tom Deary make the tackle for Pizzani now. 13 carries and 53 yards. They'll go with a hurry-up offense. The clock's still running with 35 seconds to go. Thorpe kills the clock by heaving it out of bounds, left side.
Strictly a waste down that time. Coaches always like to try to pick up some yardage, even though you're trying to stop the clock to run a route that will at least give you a completion and move the ball forward. That's kind of a wasted play. They may want that play a couple of plays from now. With only 32 seconds left, with only a 7-0 cushion, they'd like to get a score going into the locker room at halftime.
You were looking at 49-year-old Bill Badlove on the far sideline. Two wide receivers to the right side. They'll run it. Ah, that's a surprise. That's a real surprise. They went with a counterplay to the weak side. And now we'll call timeout. That'll stop the clock with 27 seconds to go in the first half. And John Thorpe wants to talk it over with Mike Kelly.
That was really a surprise play. Unless they're trying to think, set up the play action, but they kind of wasted it. They should have done that on the first down and maybe second down.
Coming up Monday night on ABC's NFL Monday Night Football, this ought to be a good one. The Pittsburgh Steelers visiting the Oakland Raiders at 9 o'clock Eastern Time. Pittsburgh suddenly a resurgent team, and they're very much alive for a playoff spot. Oakland struggling, the defending Super Bowl champions. That's 9 o'clock Eastern Time. The Steelers against the Raiders in one of the classic rivalries in NFL football. Notice the writing on the back of the Dayton jerseys. They've obviously gotten new jerseys for this game. Stagg Bowl. The Amos Alonzo Stagg Bowl, the Division III championship from Phenix City, Alabama, where it is surprisingly cold. Didn't expect this.
Pass me my gloves.
Third down and 9. 27 seconds to go. 7-0 Dayton lead. Ball at the 16-yard line. Play fake. Watch out. Warp is caught. Kaiser again. What a game he's playing. Tim Kaiser. That is his second sack of the game.
Kaiser diagnoses this play all the way. He recognizes it from a play they ran earlier when they completed the touchdown pass to Breeze Roller. They ran an option rollout, and the quarterback, Vorp, threw a strike to Roller. Tried to do it again. Number 44 is right there on top of the play. Kaiser, doctor of destruction. The tough man.
On fourth down now, Pinatello will try and tack on 3 more points, and it'll be fairly sizable. This will be a 47-yard field goal. He's 12 out of 18 on field goals this year.
Yeah, his deepest this year has been a 42-yarder. So he's got the range, particularly with that wind at his back. But it keeps changing direction, so you never know how to gauge it.
Mike Pinatello from 47 yards away. Now, timeout has been called again. Not sure who called that one. Rod Daly says Widener called it. So they're going to let Pinatello think it over a little bit. 21 seconds to go. The only score we had, the touchdown catch that Tom was just referring to, and it followed a Chris Cheney interception, 51-yard drive that went 4 plays. Featured a catch by Turkoski, a run by the slot back of 20 yards as key plays. There's Bill Manlove, and check the record, 108 wins and 23 defeats. And over the last 10 years, the record is even more impressive, 94 victories and 9 defeats.
Of course, he's undefeated this season, averaging only one loss a year for the past 9 years. And the wheels are turning, the academic wheels are turning right now as Manlove has called the timeout. Not to discuss anything on the sideline, just to give Pinatello something to think about.
We've talked about the fact that in the semis last year, Widener came back, or rather Dayton came back to win 28-24. That's our Fireman's Fund flashback coming up in a few moments. Now, Pinatello, the kick on the way. There's a flag down, the kick is there, and it's good. It is good. His longest kick of the year. But check everything now, we've got a flag. Offside, Widener, decline.
Offside, decline, 3 points.
He got it.
47 yards, 15 seconds remaining in the half.
Watch Mike Pinatello from Centerville, Ohio now. Let's it go and waits. And waits.
A little body English.
And waits.
Yeah.
All right.
Gave it a little bit of hip movement there right at the end. Waiting for that win.
Cleared the crossbar by about a foot. And Dayton has increased its lead to 10-0 over Widener. Pinatello will kick off again, or Garrett Dickey rather. Number 14 is going to do the kickoff chores. He's a starting linebacker. Left-footed squib kick. And it's down at the 30-yard line. Tim Burns, a tight end. Number 81 got on it.
Let's see.
12 seconds to go in the first half, and Dayton on top 10-0. And I'll bet you that in both locker rooms, they discussed the fact that of what happened last year in the playoffs with the lead.
That's right. Don't forget that it's 60 minutes. You got to play 4 quarters. I'm sure Dayton's going to be in their prevent defense on this particular play. have the four deep back, very deep, trying to avoid the home run strike.
They'll hand it off to Jerry Irving instead, and Irving weaves his, well, there's a fumble. And I believe Dayton has come up with it. They have at the 47-yard line with 4 seconds remaining in the first half. That was a 17-yard gain by Jerry Irving, his longest of the first half. But that is also the fourth turnover for Widener now. We've had 8 turnovers in the first half, 4 by each team. And Joe Vogel made the recovery. Watch it again as a tackle is made by Kerry Coombs, a defensive back. Then Hufford almost got it, and Vogel did. Now, 3 wide receivers to the right side. Final play in the first half. Home run ball. Deary will intercept. Tom Deary, his 11th interception of the year. And we are at halftime. Halftime, Dayton leading at 10-0. Halftime score, Dayton leading Widener 10-0. The Division III Amos Alonzo Stagg Bowl. For the national championship in Division III, these two surviving 188 football-playing Division III schools. Well, we're just about set for some more thrills here in the third quarter, Dayton and Widener. Widener team is already on the field. And here comes the University of Dayton kick team. 10-0 our score, 9 turnovers, and only 10 points. There's Bobby Cole on the far side warming up, and Bill Manlove doesn't look like a grandfather, does he?
Oh, he's got to think about it. He's got to interesting. If you believe in statistics, Widener has scored 54 points in 12 games in the third quarter, while Dayton has only given up a total of 6 in 13 games. So Manlove has got his work cut out for him, because Dayton's pretty stingy in the third quarter, so we'll have to see what Widener has talked about in that locker room at halftime.
Mike Pinatello will kick off for the University of Dayton. They will have the win behind them. And Tom Deary, who returned 100 yards last week against Montclair State, is back at the 3-yard line waiting for the kick. And nothing score from Phenix City, Alabama on a chilly Saturday afternoon for the Division III National Championship. We're underway. Deary at the 4. 20. And he'll get as far out as the 24-yard line. That'll do it. Let's take a look at the defensive lineup now for Dayton. Joe Vogel at left end. Joe Drobnich is the left tackle. Junior out of Cleveland. Jim Pearson, the nose guard, had a busy first 30 minutes of football. Fred Prozel, the right tackle. And the right end is Rick Callinan, leading tackler in that defensive line. First down and 10. And Cole wants to throw on first down. Nobody open. And he'll be caught and dropped back to the 16-yard line. Tackle made by the young man you just saw, Jim Pearson, the nose guard, number 50. Now look at Bobby Cole, who lost yardage all the way back to the 16-yard line.
Pearson is the captain. He's a returning starter from a year ago, and he's got 11 sacks coming into the ballgame.
Mark Hufford, the linebacker, and Garrett Dickey, the other linebacker in the 5-2 defense. Nick Cuglieri, the left cornerback. Clay Robinson, the right cornerback. And a pitch out around the right side. Goes to Jerry Irving, and he gets a couple. Doug Conley and Chris Cheney are the other two defensive backs.
See number 46, Irving there. He hasn't really seen the ball very much this afternoon. He's got that blazing speed, 4-6. They're going to have to try to get the ball to him more. They don't really pass that much to their running backs. It's their wide people and the tight end that they throw to, but they've got to find some way to get the ball to Irving, because he's a game breaker.
Cole is 4 out of 8 for 54 yards. He's been picked off twice, and he will throw on third down 11. As time, man is open. It's Britton. He is close for the first down and then went back, and I don't think he got it. I think he came up about a yard short. A 10-yard gain, he needed 11. Take a look now at Tony Britton trying to get the first down yardage, and he just came up a little too short.
Britton has been very active in the playoffs so far. In two games coming in, he had six receptions coming in, and here he gets one. That's about number two or three for the day for him. He was wide open on that little hook pattern across the middle.
Mark Steffen will be kicking into the wind, and Nick Rickey is the deep man. This will be Steffen's fourth punt. His longest with the wind was 50. That's a good one. Rickey at the 30-yard line. And he's tackled at the 33. Now let's take a look at the Widener defense after that 37-yard kick. Tony Stefanoni, number 64, is joined up front by Jim Devlin, the left tackle, and Bob Neely, the right tackle. And the right end is Dennis Sheedy from Conshohocken, Pennsylvania. First down, 10. Dayton's got the ball at their own 32-yard line. John Fort, the quarterback. Pappas and Pisani are the running backs. Pisani coming to the right. Gets three to the 35. Phil Arufo, the linebacker, a junior out of Marlton, New Jersey, is joined by Jeff Schreider in the middle. And Tim Kaiser, Dr. Destruction, who has a couple of sacks and a pass interception. Bob O'Toole on the right side. Jim Hirschman on the left side. Lou Irving, who had a pass interception in the first half. And Tom Deary, who also did. Second down and 7. 12-10 to go third quarter. 10-0 Dayton leads. This is Pappas, the fullback, jammed up by Stefanoni, number 64, the left end.
Very interesting call, the fact that they ran a belly play for the second down. Mike Kelly told us he wanted to avoid third down situations, passing situations, because that's not really his strength. Maybe this is going to be his attitude through the second half, to sit on the lead. He's playing very conservative on this opening drive.
See what he's got in mind now for third down and 5 with 11:30 to go third quarter. Wide receiver split left and right. Pitch out to Zanny. Blocker in front. First down at the 47-yard line. 10-yard gain. And a tackle made by Bob O'Toole. Pisani now with 70 yards on 16 carries.
Let's watch the right side of the line. That's Mike Howard, the center, number 67, Joe Beck, and Larry Armstrong clear the way for Pisani. It's the most experienced side of their offensive line. Those three host of characters leading the way for Pisani.
Had a good downfield block also from Brees Roller, number 29. Here's Pappas. Squirt through for about 3 to the 49-yard line. Dayton beginning to roll here in the third quarter. And they have a 10-0 edge. They were slight underdogs coming in, but I think you had a sense that as defending champions, they might do it.
Yeah, I think you also got to take into consideration the fact that Widener has got to be the aggressor in the ballgame, because they're the ones who are shooting for the mountain, not Dayton. They've already been there.
10:54 to go. Third quarter, 10-0 game. Safety blitz threatened by Tom Deary. Here he comes. And he helps jam things up. And then Stefanoni was on top, number 64. And they got Pisani with no gain. It'll be third down. Here's a look at Stefanoni, whose brother Adam is the starting center on this ball club. One of two brother combinations for Widener. The other being the Irving boys.
The Irvings have another brother. He's at Westchester
State.
That's
right, yeah.
They tried to get him here, too. Didn't quite make it. He's got 4-4 speed.
Third. Four fumbles, falls on it, it'll be fourth down. And again, Tony Stefanoni is in the area, number 64.
I think Stefanoni's falling down on the play. He just kind of reaches up and sticks a mitt in to pull it away from Vorp. He doesn't give up as Pisani's picking up number 66 on the left side of your screen. And there's Stefanoni. Maybe it's one of the guards, I think the center, Mike Howard, just kind of stuck a foot up and a cleat knocked the ball loose.
Lon Marino on to punt on fourth down. Stefanoni comes through, nice kick, Deary, fair catch. And he grabs it at the 27-yard line. So we have had an exchange of possessions here in the third quarter. No threat of a score, a 33-yard punt. 9:34 to go in quarter number 3, timeout on the field. 9:34 to go, third quarter. And the Widener Pioneers have the ball at their own 27. Cole pops it out of the right flat behind Tom Kincaid. The catch is made, but it's a gain of about three when it might have been six or seven. Kincaid's fourth catch of the day. He's caught four for 42 yards. And he got 39 coming in.
Strictly a timing play where the receiver's got to just kind of take the steps and give the illusion that he's getting a lot of depth downfield just to get the ball to him really quickly and give him a chance to run because he's got the speed.
There's the option play. Pitches it back. Jerry Irving out to the 37. Rick Callanan, number 86, made the tackle. Looks like it could be enough for the first down. Maybe just a foot or two shy. Coming up, the Gator Bowl, North Carolina versus Arkansas. That'll be Monday, December 28th, prime time for you, live 9 o'clock Eastern time. And the Sugar Bowl, Georgia, well out in front of Georgia Tech at the half, will take on Pittsburgh. That's New Year's Day. That's also prime time, 8 o'clock Eastern time. Stretch of the chain, now they got the first down 10. That is only the sixth Widener first down of the ballgame, as they have been held in check defensively by their strong Dayton defense. It's 10-0 with 8:45 to go, third quarter. And here's Bobby Cole leading his troops up to the line of scrimmage. That one goes to Clofine, Gary Clofine, and Jim Pearson, the nose guard, made the tackle again. Down at the bottom of that stack, number 50, number 43 is Clofine from Havertown, Pennsylvania.
You might wonder why they're being so conservative running the football with 8:21 left on the clock. They're trying to set up the play action passes because that's what they're most effective at throwing. Cole is trying to establish that so he can throw the ball to get it into Kincaid or some of their wide people.
Second down and seven. Cole still has it. Now pitches it back to Irving. He gets a minimal amount of blocking help up front and is down at the 45-yard line and is hurt. Jerry Irving, 1,000-yard rusher for Widener. They don't want to lose him, obviously. And the training staff comes on out to the field. Irving hit at the 45-yard line.
I don't believe they've got four or five speeds sitting on that bench. You got to have him. You got to have Irving in the ballgame.
He's been the key to the offense this year. And there was a personal foul penalty tacked on at the end of the play of 15 yards. Rod Daly talking it over, and Irving may have been a dead ball foul. Let's see. They have walked off 15. Take a look at it again, Tom.
Well, we may have a late hit here. We'll try to watch Irving as he makes this cut here. We'll watch to see when he goes down. When is he down? He's down here, and then we get a little late hit. One of the Dayton players came in and hit him after the play was dead.
Oh, that ball is almost intercepted. Picked off almost by Doug Conley, number one. Well, Irving is on the bench. Looked like Fred Prozel, the defensive tackle, was shoved into Irving. I don't think it was intentional at all.
Right. See it from another angle.
Well, this is the pass play.
This is the pass play here, okay. You get a tip here. Just good play on the part of the linebacker, getting a hand up, batting the ball away.
Second down and 10 at the 40-yard line. Tony Britton on the reverse. And that's good for the gain of four to the 36. Chip Robinson, number 98, made the tackle on Britton. That is Britton's fourth carry for 16 yards in the game. Irving on the bench has been pretty much held in check. It'll be third down and seven. And I think Irving's back in there. Here's Cole back to throw. Comes left side. It's caught by Britton. No, he missed it. He bobbled the ball on the way down. Incomplete pass.
He almost shielded that with his body, but the striped shirts were right on top of the play. As you see, Cole going back here. Steps up in the pocket very, very well here. He's getting a lot of pressure from the outside. Gets a nice strike into the receiver here, but Britton drops it as he's being tackled here, and the striped shirts caught it, because he's right there in the shadows. They might have missed that, but they got it.
Fourth down and six, and Widener will kick it away. Into the wind, Mark Steffen is the punter, and Nick Rickey waits back at the 10-yard line. He'll go for the right corner. That's a dandy kick, but it'll go on into the end zone. Touchback, it comes out to the 20. Exactly 7 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Widener unable to get into the end zone thus far, and they have now given up the football. Dayton's got it at the 20-yard line. University of Dayton is about to run its 52nd offensive play of the game. They have run 20 more than Widener so far. One reason they've got a 10-point lead. John Vorp will hand it off to his fullback, Hayner. He's still dreaming about that 56-yard run.
You're absolutely right.
He gets a couple. It's out to the 22-yard line.
Again, Dayton got here because they beat Lawrence last week 38 to nothing. And, of course, the Pioneers of Widener got here because of a 23-12 win last week over Montclair State.
Here's our Bill Manlove on the far side. 13 years he's been at Widener College. Second down and eight. Look at this hole. And Pisani is out near the 29-yard line. Tackle made by Tim Kaiser. Watching Bill Manlove, I was curious to what he told you yesterday about why he has chosen to stay in Widener for 13 years.
Well, you figure you've got to... We'll take a look here. We'll get back to that. You see here, Vorp handing off to Pisani. Big hole on the trap play. But he decides that I want to pick it up a little bit more. And Kaiser comes up. That's kind of head-on-head. Big stars hitting each other at the same time, trying to see who's going to give ground.
Straight T formation, third down and one. Hayner gets it, and I think he's got enough to keep the chains moving to the south. Looks like he picked up the first down and 10. Now then, Manlove.
Yeah, Manlove says his phone's not ringing. He says, as far as he's concerned, AT&T is out of business. Nobody's calling him saying, hey, beating his doors down, saying, hey, I got a job for you. He says that Division III is basically kind of looked down upon by Division II, Division I. If they're going to go looking for coaches, they stay within their own backyard. And he's very happy where he is. He's very, very happy where he is.
Said he's got his niche carved out at Widener College, and he's quite content to be the head coach right there. Here's Bart on the keeper out to the 33-yard line. Then as Sheedy, number 66, made the tackle. Clock shows 5:08 to go third quarter, 10-0 lead. Dayton scored in the first quarter on a 13-yard touchdown pass from that man to Brees Willer. And then just prior to halftime, a 47-yard field goal by Mike Pinatello, longest of his career. Second down, six. Slot I formation, straight to the left side. The reverse. The Canes with a blocker in front. And he gets it out to the 37-yard line and is shoved into the Dayton bench. Tom Deary made the tackle. Watch this All-American free safety, number 13, Tom Deary.
You can hear all the way up here in the booth, we heard the players for Widener yelling, reverse, reverse. So they've seen this play on films in preparation for the ball game. And Deary comes up and just throws his body, sticks his helmet in to make the stop.
Third and four. Changing at the line. Safety blitz threatened by Deary. Timeout. And he didn't get it called in time. He used more than the allotted 25 seconds. We've got a delay of game. That'll cost him five. Southwest Texas State playing in San Marcos under head coach Jim Wacker, leading Northern Michigan in the second quarter in a Division II semifinal. North Dakota State and Shippensburg State are tied in the third quarter. Winners of those two games will meet in the Palm Bowl in McAllen, Texas next week. Eastern Kentucky, a 21-7 lead at halftime over Delaware. Eastern Kentucky handed Dayton its only defeat. And Boise State and Jackson State are scoreless in the first quarter. Third down and eight now. And again, Perry threatening the blitz, doesn't go. Zanny tries to break a tackle and can, it'll be fourth down. Tony Stefanoni, number 64, made the stop. Mustachioed young man out of Florence, New Jersey. And Georgia, way out on top of Georgia Tech at the half. They're going to finish the regular season 10 wins and one defeat. And you'll see them in the Sugar Bowl on ABC on New Year's night. Here's a look at Lon Marino on the punt. And and Tom Deary to return it. This one will bounce right into Deary's arms. Watch him go. He's got two men to beat. Gets a great block, and now it's a foot race. Deary will score. Return and watch him one more time.
He got a great bounce. The Dayton coverage broke down because they saw the ball bounce. They thought they would be able to just kind of touch it down. They didn't think Deary was going to go anywhere near it. He breaks it and goes all the way, 76 yards on the return.
There's the kick. Got it. A 42-yard punt, but the return was 76 yards. Widener's on the boards. They have cut the margin to three. Widener crowd on the far side, and they've gotten pepped up now following that 76-yard return by Tim Deary. And watch the block from Jim Smith at the end of it.
Absolutely. That's a pioneer who got a reprieve because in the first half, he was guilty of running into the punter, causing a loss of the ball. Number 22 right there, that's the big part of the play, and Deary just turns on the speed and outraces the rest of the Dayton Flyers. 2 weeks in a row that he's turned in big return touchdowns to kind of bail his team out to bring him back in the second half.
Nick Pulis, number 5, will kick off. Nick Cuglieri is the deep man, and here's a squib kick that is picked up by Nick Rickey, number 39. Rickey weaving his way out to the 28-yard line before he is tackled. And the tackle is made by Lou Irving. A 13-yard return for Nick Rickey. Well, what a great block it was from Jim Smith at about the 45 that got Tom Deary around the corner. And then he turned on the afterburners. 10-7 game with 3:27 to go, third quarter. Home, so fourth runs it out to the 31-yard line. Bob Beely, number 83, made the tackle.
He was looking out to the right side, looking for his receiver. Don't think his receiver was on the same page he was on, because he was looking for a quick slant to the right side. His receiver on that side of the flank was not looking at him, so he decided to eat the ball and go up the middle.
Second down and 8 with 3 minutes exactly to go, third quarter. Both wide receivers are split to the left side this time. This is Hayner again. And Tom Hayner breaks it out to the 35-yard line. That's his 6th carry in the ballgame. Phil Arufo, number 56, made the tackle. Big number 79 is Dave Merrill, the right guard, a senior out of Geneva, Ohio. Turkowski brings the play in, number 5, third down and 3. With 2:25 to go, third quarter. Slot eye formation. Hayner and Bazzani behind John Gore. Let's it go. Caught by Roller. What a catch. What a fine catch by Brees Roller. A gain of 15 yards and a first down at midfield.
Second big catch of the day by Roller. Touchdown earlier in the first half. Touchdown reception by him. This time he runs a corner route to the sidelines. Then he squares it off, keeps the foot in bounds. Knows exactly where he is, reaches up, extends his body, makes the catch.
He's caught 3 for 35 yards. His first down, 10 at the 50-yard line. Pitch out, Bazzani. Hayner gets a good block. Bazzani cuts it back to the right instead of going to the left. Might have been more advantageous to use Hayner's block going left, but he cut it back upfield.
as a player, having been in this position before where you've had a lead throughout the ball game and you haven't scored for a long time, and you don't have the adrenaline constantly pumping up, now Dayton has got to compose themselves and get it pumping again. Very, very difficult. 10-7 score, Dayton ahead of Widener and driving.
Second down and 8 with a minute 34 to go third quarter.
Let's go!
Gain this time. Bob Neely, number 83 down there. So was Tony Stefanoni, number 64. And Jeff Schreider, number 50. Bazzani now with 81 yards on 21 carries.
Difference here, both teams are on the same emotional pitch because Widener's coming up with the adrenaline. Dayton has now got to come up, but now it's a matter of physical strength and depth. Dayton has a slight edge in that category with a lot of strength. They've got a strength program just for that endurance situation.
Third down and 9. Blitz is coming. More blitz it. Go incomplete. Intended for his tight end, Kirk Ambrose. Watch Tony Stefanoni, number 64, get pressure on John Thorpe now and force him to pull up a little short.
He's going to try to sprint out. Again, very successful so far in the ball game on it. Lou Irving is downfield, has pretty good angle on the receiver as well. No chance for the completion, but the pressure by Stefanoni was what turned the play around.
Marino will kick it away to the man who just scored, the only Widener touchdown, Tom Deary. Lon Marino. Return is on all the way. Not this time. It's a 37-yard punt, 2 on the return. And the clock stops on the change of possessions with 40 seconds to go in the third quarter. This is the first of our doubleheader on NCAA college football today. And coming up next, one of the traditional clashes in all of college football. Army versus Navy from Philadelphia, live at 3:45 Eastern time. First down 10, Bob Cole. Back split behind him. Hands it off on the left side. And the Widener defense stiffens. 29 seconds to go. We'll have one more play in this quarter.
I talked about the strength situation, Vern. Relative to Dayton, they've got 42 of their players can bench press over 300 pounds. And that's the strength program instituted by Mike Kelly, the head coach. He wants them to be able to last until the fourth quarter. That's what they're really into at this point.
Here's Cole keeping it and cut down. Tackle made by Chris Cheney, the All-American free safety. And that's it for the third quarter of play. NCAA Division III championship game, Widener versus Dayton, will continue after this commercial message and a word from our local stations. Widener and Dayton. Widener has a third down and 3, and they trail by 3, 10-7. Bob Cole will throw it. Pumps once. In trouble. Lets it go deep. Double coverage downfield. Incomplete. Excellent defensive work by Chris Cheney and Dennis Coper, number 11. It was intended for Tom Kincaid. And Widener is now 0-for-8 on third down conversions.
Cole tried to get him on a kind of an out, up, and go pattern. Tried to get it to Kincaid. No chance. Excellent coverage, as you pointed out, Vernon, in the secondary. He even waved off a would-be tackler in that backfield to try to give him some time to set it up, but no way. They've got to punt it away now as Stefan drops back for the punt.
Nick Rickey is the deep man, and Stefan will have the win behind him, and he takes advantage of it. That's a great kick. Rickey over the shoulder at the 26. Gets one block, but there are 3 Widener men downfield to make the tackle. That's a 51-yard kick and only 3 on the return. The tackle made by Brian Collins at the end of 3 quarters. Take a look at this. Look at that. The key thing to me, Tom, is the rushing yardage. Now, Dayton had been averaging around 219. They've got 195.
Right.
Widener had been averaging 214, and they've only had 78 yards rushing today. So the Dayton defense has been one of the dominant forces in this game. High formation and Thorpe to throw. Across the middle, he pops it for Krakowski, and he breaks the tackle, and watch out! A 28-yard gain. Dave Turkoski.
Turkoski just kind of hooks up, finds an open seam in the middle here, gathers himself after a great hit inside by Widener, shakes it off. He really doesn't have a lot of speed. He's that Raymond Berry type of receiver who knows how to get open. His theory, the All-American, the big play man, tries to make an ankle tackle here. You can't do it. You got to watch all the way, even the big guys.
Flag is down, pitch back. Zanny is caught after a gain of about three. Tim Kaiser made the stop again, but it'll be a five-yard penalty against the University of Dayton. Rod Daly is our referee. We're just underway in the fourth quarter of this NCAA Division III championship game. From Phenix City, Alabama, 14 minutes to go in the ball game. 5 yards, and here's the call from Rod Daly.
Motion on the back.
That sets up a first down and 15. Nate closing in on 200 yards rushing. Ball. John Borp. Pitch out. Zanny. Got one. Tony Stefanoni. Number 64 makes the tackle again. For Pizzani, that's 22 carries. 81 yards and second down and 15. And Rick Haynes, number 20, brings the play in. From Mike Kelly, the Dayton coach.
Widener was coming straight across that time. They didn't really go for the fake at all. Forbes tried to hold it in there, but they weren't going for it. They were coming straight ahead, and they knew exactly where the ball carrier was.
Second down and 14. Forbes lets it go. Great catch by Priest Roller. That's a 13-yard gain. It'll be 2 yards short of the first down, but Roller with his fourth catch of the day. Number 29. Sets up a third and two on third down conversions. Dayton is 5 out of 14 so far. Turkoski and Roller both go to the right. Mazzani and Hainer are in the backfield in the eye. Timeout. Borp didn't like the defensive alignment he was confronting, and he'll talk it over with Mike Kelly. Mike Kelly, 33 years of age, in his first year as the head coach. That was not Kelly that John Borp was talking with. 10-7 is the score. One has a sense, though, Tom, that Dayton should be farther out in front. They really have pretty well dictated the tempo of the game.
They really have dominated play, but as you pointed out, we keep pointing out the adrenaline in the championship game has a lot to do with it. The emotional aspect of the ball game cannot be taken away here. And Widener, they want it. I mean, they want to get back in it. And again, Kaiser is one of the players who has a championship ring from 1977. And he's been here before. He wants another one. He's got one on the left hand. He wants one on the right hand. He wants a pair. And he's been one of the inspirational players, along with Deary, back there in that secondary, trying to keep Widener in the ballgame.
Ball is at the 35-yard line. Straight tee in the backfield. Hainer gets the handoff, and he may have enough for the first down. Tom Hainer, number 32. I think they'll have to bring the chain out and see. Yep. Rod Daly says bring the chain across. Number 20 is Jim Hirschman. He and Deary waiting to see if indeed Dayton got enough. With 12:17 to go, third quarter. Stretch. Yeah, I got it.
I think the wind blew one blade of grass on the other side of the ball, you know?
I think you're right. There's 49-year-old Bill Manlove on the far side. Head coach at Widener. 10-7 ball game. First down, 10, Dayton. Thorpe is asking for the crowd to quiet down, the Dayton band. Pitch out. Mazzani inside the 30 to the 29-yard line. Chewed up a chunk of yardage that time on his 23rd carry of the game. And he's picked up 85 yards now. Bob Feely and Dennis Sheedy made the tackle defensively for Widener. Mazzani only recently regained his health after that broken ankle. And has been a big cog in the offensive fireworks today for Dayton Flyers. Second down, six. Handoff goes to the fullback, Hayner. And he's down to the 28-yard line. Tackle made by Jeff Schreider, the middle linebacker, number 50. Hayner with eight carries for 72 yards now. They've got a third down and five, and I suppose think field goal if they don't get the first down, but they've got a three-point lead. Need a little more than that for a cushion. A lot more than that. Fourth play fake. Blitz coming. Across the middle it goes to Krakowski. First down at the 16-yard line. Tom Deary made the tackle, but it's another third down conversion. 11-yard gain for Dave Krakowski, his third catch of the day.
Krakowski just running a very soft post pattern here. Not a deliberate post, just kind of crossing it, feeling his way, leading the quarterback to him rather than the quarterback leading the ball to him. Fort sticks it in there, knows exactly where to put it.
First down at the 16-yard line in a 10-7 game. Dayton leading. Hand off to Pisani. He's down to the 13 and maybe the 12. Bob Feely, number 83, makes the tackle. And we've got 10:15 to go, and Dayton just rolling along, chewing up time and space.
A completion like that between Vorp and Krakowski takes a lot of practice with each other. They have a feel for each other. They know exactly what kind of commitment the receiver's going to make, and Vorp sits there and just kind of waits and says, I'll lead you wherever you want to go.
Second down, seven. Safety blitz coming. Pitch back, fumble. And Mazzani falls on it, and Kaiser hits him about the time he gets to the football. Really gave him a pop. And again, I think the safety blitz may have affected the exchange.
Yeah, because Vorp has had trouble looking at the defense. They come up the blitz, and he's getting confused, throws his timing off, and they get that penetration right in the eyesight of where he's trying to pitch that option. Mazzani very wisely just falls on the ball rather than try to advance it, trying to pick the ball up.
See the clock with 9:20 to go, and it's unraveling. Play fake again, Vorp. Fumble, Widener's got it. Bob Feely recovers, number 83. There is also a flag down. There is a flag at the point of the fumble recovery. Widener's got it. There's a dead ball foul. It'll cost him 15, and we'll be right back. 9:11 to go in the ball game. Another turnover. This is the sixth given up by the Dayton team. Watch the fumble again.
I think Vorp is going to get a mitt from number 66, Sheedy, the defensive end, who stuck his arm and his fist behind his back and knocked the ball loose from Vorp.
Bobby Cole leads the Widener offense up. Handoff goes in the left side to Gary Clopine. By the way, Jerry Irving is back in the lineup. The tailback who was hurt a little earlier. Turnovers now. We've had 10 in the game, and one would expect to see a high-scoring game in that respect. But 10-7 is the way it stands right now.
They just haven't been able to take advantage that much of the turnovers and turn them into scores. But Dayton has controlled a lot of this second half.
Second down and five. Widener, slot man on the left side. Watch the play, pitch back. Jerry Irving. Gets a block. He's got a first down to the 48-yard line. Tackle is made by Gareth Dickey, the linebacker number 14, but Irving around the left side gets a first and 10.
Irving runs a lot like OJ. Kind of sits back and kind of waits. A lot of his weight on his heels rather than up on his toes, so he maintains his balance all the way and can run with power.
8:19 to go in the game. Widener has not had a sustained drive yet today. Cole to throw. Man is wide open. Tom Kincaid at the 18-yard line. First and 10, Widener, a 30-yard gain.
Let's take a look from behind the offense, behind Cole, and see his view of the field. Got a belly fake, got the option wide open, had a chance to freeze and turn around the secondary there as Kincaid makes the grab and goes out of bounds.
Dayton was driving for what appeared to be a cinch touchdown, or a cinching touchdown, and now Cole has it. Pitch back, Irving jammed up, caught and dropped at the 19. He fumbled but recovered. 7:55 to go. And all of a sudden, this Widener team has gotten it inside the 20-yard line.
Coming into the ballgame, Cole's only a 40% passer during the course of the season. Seems to be throwing a lot hotter than that this ballgame.
He's 7 out of 14 now for 98 yards, has been intercepted twice. Scramble, fumble. Widener got it back at the 20.
Well, they've gotten two gifts on this play. Ball's been shaken loose twice. Dayton not in the right place at the right time.
Now then, Tom, third and 13. Got to think Kincaid, I would assume.
That's who they've been going to in the clutch so far. We'll take another look at the fumble on that last play. Cole just had nowhere to go with the ball as far as passing it. Again, the stripping type of tackle has been going on. Fred Frizzell is the one who made the stop that time.
Draw play, Britton, touchdown! Tony Britton, 20 yards on third and 13. The first third down conversion for Widener today. They are 1 out of 9. And all of a sudden, after a fumble recovery, a big pass play, a run from Irving, their first sustained drive of the day, and they've got the lead of 3 points. Here's the kick for Mark Steffen. He got it. Watch this touchdown run from Tony Britton.
Britton is a player who came to Widener the year after the 77 championship team set a goal for himself that I want a championship ring. He's driving toward that goal right now as he scores, making the score 14-10 with 6:46 left on the clock. We'll be back.
Nick Poulos will kick off now for Widener. They're on top for the first time, 14-10. 6:46 to go in the ballgame. Nick Rickey, he'll drop to one knee, it'll come out to the 20. Well, 1 year ago in the semifinals, Widener had a 24-0 lead and couldn't score in the second half, and Dayton beat them 28-24. Take a look at the scoring drive. 6 plays, 61 yards, took 225, and Britton got the touchdown for 20. Here in the championship game, Dayton had a 10-0 halftime lead. They haven't scored again. Widener's put together a 76-yard punt return and a 20-yard touchdown run, and they have a lead of 14-10. Amazing how the coin flipped. Look at this. Hayner, the big fullback, got to the 30-yard line. First down. Lou Irving and Tom Deary make the tackle, and 11-yard gain. He's having his best day of the season. That'll move the chain to the north. It's 14-10 with 6:30 to go. John Thorpe brings him up. Thorpe, 8 out of 15 for 121. Throw it away. Total offense in the game, still overwhelmingly in Dayton's favor. They've got 307 yards. 313 to 207 for Widener College. That doesn't matter, does it?
Sure doesn't. That was a wise decision on Forbes' part that last time. Nowhere to go. Throw it out of bounds where there's nobody who can pick it off.
Clock stopped with 6:13 to go. Second down and 10 at the 31. Got him. Dennis Sheedy, number 66, the last man up. Warp is sacked.
Guess where he was trying to go? Trying to go deep to number 29, Brees Roller, his favorite target. And he was double covered by Deary and Hirschman.
Third and 15 with 5:43 to go. Hayner's average 9.1. His average coming in was 2.3. Intercept. Oh, dropped. Jim Smith let it go right through his hands. He had it. He's had a big day today, though. Got the key block on the punt return. Also got caught, unfortunately, with a roughing the kicker call. But the Dayton drive stalls, and Widener's going to get it back with 5:20 to go in the game. That's the Widener pep band on the far side. Bit of a low snap for Marino. The kick is away into the wind. Fair catch call by Tom Deary at the 47-yard line. That's a kick of only 28 yards. Widener has the lead and the ball. And they've got it with 5:15 remaining in the Division III championship game. 5:15 remaining in the ball game. Widener with a four-point lead and the football at their own 47-yard line. They have scored the only two touchdowns here in the second half. They come from behind and take the lead in the championship game. Hand off to Jerry Irving. He squirts over his center's back and gets it out to the 49-yard line. Tackle made by Rick Callanan, number 86. Irving now with 55 yards in the game on 15 carries. It'll be second down and 6. 4:55 to go. Clock running.
Tough position to be in here. You want to try to consume a lot of the clock on the drive, but not be too cautious. Don't want to sit on the lead.
Tom, defensively, do you start looking for the turnover now, trying to force the fumble? Look at this. Cole was going to throw it, and nobody there.
I think,
in other words, we may see them tackle the ball now.
I think so. You may see a lot of missed tackles as a result. Widener may break one here because the red shirts of Dayton will be trying to strip the ball, trying to cause a fumble.
Look at the total yardage in the game. 320 for Dayton, 211 for Widener, and 61 of those yards came on their last drive, the touchdown drive.
Dayton right on their average, 337 yards total offense per game throughout the season. So they're right on their game, but haven't put points on the board.
Third and 4 with 4 minutes to go in the game. Cole will throw it. Across the middle, incomplete. Chris Cheney diving for his third interception of the game, but he couldn't get there quite in time. Nonetheless, Dayton will get it back at least one more time. And Nick Ricky goes back to return the punt of Mark Steffen. There's a look at Ricky. Nick Ricky waiting at the 10-yard line with 3:56 to go. See if Dayton is coming after Mark Steffen, the punter, now, or if they've got the return on all the way. I think now they're coming, and they're not going to get there. Great kick by Steffen into the end zone. It'll come out to the 20-yard line, and that wasted 8 more seconds on the clock. So Dayton has the ball, but they're 80 yards away. They're going into the wind, and they've got 3 minutes and 48 seconds in which to accomplish this task. 3:48 to go. Dayton's got it 80 yards away. It does not sound simple, nor will it be. Warp on the roll to the right. He's caught and dropped for a loss back at the 17-yard line. Tackle is made by Phil Arupo, number 56. They're heading in the wrong direction.
Widener's pumped up right now. They see that clock. They're right in the face of the clock. 3:31 as it ticks down.
Just amazing to me how this thing turned around. Dayton had a 10-7 lead, and they were inside the 15-yard line when on a third down play, they had their sixth turnover. There was a dead ball foul, and all of a sudden, Widener went 61 yards. Here's Thorpe. Fumble. Widener's got it. Dennis Sheedy picked it off. Tim Kaiser celebrates. Look at it again.
Seemed like everybody fell asleep on the play after the fumble. Thorpe is looking downfield. Excellent coverage. Ball pops loose, kind of rolling around. Nobody's looking. All of a sudden, oh, there's the big skin. Let's get it.
That is the seventh turnover. Kaiser forced the fumble. That is the seventh turnover for Dayton. Up the middle it goes. Forward, the running back. And it's down to the 2-yard line. 2:46 to go in the game. Kincaid goes left. Tim Burns, the tight end, is tied right. Cole to the one. Garrett Dickey makes the stop on number 12. Third and goal from the one with 2:23 to go in the game. .213 remaining.
Mr. Cole has a knack of being a hero in playoff games. A year ago, two touchdowns in the semis and in the final championship. Unbelievable.
Fumble! Recovered at the one. Bobby Cole got his own fumble and recovered it, but the clock's still going. 1:45 to go in the game. Watch it again.
Well, we're going to see the fumble here on the exchange. Cole makes the recovery.
90 seconds to go in the game. Fourth down at the 1-yard line. Timeout. And the timeout has been called by Widener. They will stop the clock with 1:28 to go in the ball game and a 14-10 lead, and they've got it at the 1-yard line. I want to thank our spotter today, Tom Lundquist out of Dallas, and Dave Yagi, our regular statistician. Travel with us around the country this year doing NCAA college football. Nice job, guys. And we've got a fourth down with 1:28 to go in the game. Seven turnovers now, four fumbles lost, and three passes intercepted by Dayton. Widener gave it up four times in the first half, but they haven't yet. Now, Manlove seems to be signaling for another timeout. If they get it, it would be his second NCAA Division III championship. They won here in 1977. And they are going to call yet one more timeout. Now there seems to be some confusion. And finally, Bobby Cole hurries on the field. Manlove wanted yet one more. They're going to have to hurry to get the playoff before the 30 of the 25-second clock. Nope, they didn't get it. Didn't get it. There was all kinds of confusion.
They were trying to make up their mind whether they wanted the field goal, then do I want to go for six? What exactly should I do? Not really sure.
Here's a call.
Delay of game offense.
So, Mark Steffen will try his second field goal of the game. He missed one wide to the right side in the first quarter. This will be straight ahead, and he'll kick it from the 13-yard line, a 23-yard effort. Steffen, 14 of 19 now for the year. And this would give Widener a 17-0 lead, but still exists the possibility of a tie. Steffen's kick is good. And with 1:25 remaining, Widener has increased its lead now to 17-0, to 17-10. We'll return with the kickoff in a moment. Back for the final 1:25 at 17-10. Nick Poulos is getting ready to kick off now for Widener College. Nick Rickey getting to ready to return it. There's a look at Poulos, number five. Coming up next, the Army-Navy game, second half of our NCAA doubleheader. And the Division III championship, only 85 seconds away from being settled. Here's the kick, Rickey at the three-yard line. The reverse is faked, he's still got it. Looks for blocks, gets it out to the 26-yard line. That's a 22-yard return, the tackle made by Jim Hirschman. And this time, with 1:16 to go in the game, Dayton is 74 yards away. Widener has scored 17 unanswered points here in the second half. Touchdown that put them on top. A 20-yard run by Tony Britton that followed a 76-yard punt return by Tom Deering. Morphy fires it out, incomplete. Intended for Roller at the 35. Second and 10. And we have made the selection of our Chevrolet most valuable players in the game for Widener. Tom Deary, the All-American free safety, has one interception in the day and a 76-yard return. And Tom Hayner, the fullback, his best day at Dayton. He has picked up 82 yards and 9 carries. And in their honor, $1,000 scholarships to the general scholarship fund at each school. Warp across the middle behind Rick Haynes, but he makes the catch. No, he didn't. He did not hang on to it. And the clock stops with 1:06 to go in the ball game. It'll be third down and 10. Both teams looking for their second NCAA Division III championship. Dayton hoping to defend. They won it last year. Widener College won it in 1977. Third and 10 with 1:06 remaining. Blitz coming. Kaiser got him. Boy, Tim Kaiser has had a great day. Kaiser has had a sensational day. And during the commercial break, Tom and I were talking about the MVP, and we were both thinking Kaiser, but we gave it to Deary because of the big play that he made, the punt return that really ignited Widener. But I'll tell you, Kaiser has really had a sensational day.
If you could give away two, those are the two it would go to.
That's right. 7 seconds to go, and take another look at Tim Kaiser, the senior out of Essington, Pennsylvania.
He'll be coming from the right side of your screen here, number 44. Look for him all the way untouched on the blitz. Goes right over the top, makes the stop.
Now he's had a fine afternoon. And it now comes down to a fourth down at 21. That is the 7th time that Vorp has been stopped for minus 65 yards today. 7th quarterback trap. Dayton coaches talking it over on the near sideline. Widener College, 37 seconds away from getting the victory.
There's Mike Kelly there putting the headsets back on. 37 seconds left to go. Don't know what kind of conversation he can have upstairs, but he'll be trying. Maybe way upstairs, maybe a little further than the stadium.
Fourth down, 21. Roller comes near side. Tarkowski is wide to the right. Safety blitz is threatened. That'll do it. That will do it. Goes over at the 5-yard line. Widener College gets it with 28 seconds to go in the game. An amazing second half turnaround. So typical or similar to what happened a year ago when these same two teams met in the semifinal game. Almost an exact duplicate of that, except the teams have switched.
Manlov saying, learn from your mistakes. He played for 60 minutes. That's the name of the game.
Bobby Cole falls down. He will go out with the championship ring, he and his teammates. Clock is going with 18 seconds remaining, 17. There's Bill Manlove, 13th year. Game to Widener, look at it. Isn't that a great shot? A handshake with Mike Kelly. And a celebration. With their heads hung low, it'll take a while for this defeat to wear off. Don't get to this point very often, but the celebration unrestrained among Bill Manlove and the Widener College Pioneers, the 1981 NCAA Division III champions. Presentation is forthcoming. The trophy will go to the Widener Pioneers. We'll be back to see all of that from Phenix City, Alabama. Tom Gatewood is down on the field, and he'll be talking with Bill Manlove shortly. There's the plaque from Rod Shipper of the NCAA and Bill Manlove. Somewhere in that madhouse is Tom Gatewood. He's standing by, ready to talk with Bill. What a turnaround for this Widener College team in the second half. His kids may not let Bill down long enough to talk with Tom Gatewood.
Okay, I'm on the field with the winning head coach here of Widener, Bill Manlove, and got a lot of confusion, a lot of yelling here. How do you feel?
I feel just fine, Tom. It was a great victory for a group of guys that just didn't know how to quit all year.
What do you think was the turning point in the ball game for you?
Well, it's no question about it. Tom Deary's punt return put us in the ball game.
What's going through your mind right now, this very moment?
I just can't thank the good Lord enough. I'll tell you, we were certainly blessed this season.